Welcome to the Taylor James Show, where we pair extraordinary wine with extraordinary musicians. Today, our special guest is Canadian country music star, Aaron Pritchett. We'll hear all about his very humble beginnings as a DJ that led to opening for Garth Brooks. But first, everything wine to pair the perfect wine to complement Aaron's unique talent. Well, here we are. We're at Everything Wine in the River District, and I'm so excited. This is a new store. It is so magnificent and massively huge. I can't even imagine what it takes to stock a store of this size. So we're very, very excited that Everything Wine decided to join us in our little adventure of pairing music and wine and artists together. So we're featuring Lisa, and so of course we have Jeff. Jeff is our band sommelier. He knows a little bit about wine.
Yeah.
I drank a lot of wine.
Yeah. So today we decided we're going to pair Aaron Pritchett with your store.
Yeah.
So we described Aaron as a hometown country boy.
Yeah. Tireless entertainer.
Tireless entertainer.
Strong personality.
Yes.
Funny as heck. Big joy of living kind of guy. Very talented musician, writer.
Yeah.
I think he's a very special guy.
Yeah.
And many Canadians too as well.
You heard some of his music. Mm-hmm. You two went walking around the store.
And yeah.
So you guys tell us what happened.
Perfect.
Well, I think at first I thought he's going to appreciate a big, bold barbecue red wine that everybody in the group will enjoy, and it's going to be a crowd pleaser like he is. And we thought initially, let's go right to a sort of a big, flavorful American Cabernet Sauvignon. And we looked around the shelf, and Lisa thought that the Hess, you can talk about
it a little
bit.
Yeah, you can tell us about what your thoughts are on that.
What gravitated you towards that pick?
This one I find it always offers very kind of across the board. It's always delicious. It's always that really ripe, juicy style.
Consistent.
It's consistent every year.
Like Aaron.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like this is a very elegant kind of example, and Napa Valley is very well recognized.
Yes.
And so I think this is a really a good go-to for that style, and I think everyone really enjoys it. I love recommending this one. Yeah.
And you also said, let's go maybe slightly off the beaten trail.
Yeah.
And look at what Spain has to offer. And you had this idea, and I thought it was fantastic. Even though I was uncertain of the blend of grapes, it looks stunning.
So for this one here, the nice thing about some of the wines from Spain is they do tend to use a little bit more American oak. So you get a little bit more of that vanilla, kind of intense flavors. And so it's really approachable for someone who maybe doesn't drink wine all the time. This one does have the Cabernet in it, which is really approachable.
Yeah.
But then you've also got the Garnacha, which has that nice juicy flavor to it. So a blend of what you know and what's kind of new and exciting. So that was kind of the recommendation and thought behind that.
That might pair well with Aaron.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then finally, we thought, because he is a good BC boy, and Nickel Vineyards produces some amazing stuff, and Lisa, you actually worked here for a while.
Oh,
yeah,
really?
I did.
Yeah.
So Nickel Vineyards, they've got the oldest Syrah vineyards in BC, and very true to their roots, very family-oriented business. It was a man and his wife, and they actually sold to another couple. They're now doing everything the same that the original owners had done. And so they're really staying true to the style.
Yeah.
And
so this is really family. This is small?
Yes, very small. I think when I was there a couple years ago, they did about 5,000 cases.
Wow.
So you'd have to go all the way to the end of the Narrametta Betch to go visit them. They're only really in the smaller stores, maybe some restaurants, and then at the wine shop.
And did you say those are some of the oldest Syrah vines in the Okanagan?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. They're probably up to 30 years at this point now.
And I think Aaron lived in the Kelowna area for a bunch of years, so I think he would probably even have a relationship with, if not Nickel, the area, and knows the wines well.
Yeah.
And I think that would be a real winner. Well, I love all these choices. I just think because of the BC connection and his sort of small town roots, and how great and amazing that wine is, that I think that might be a good choice.
I think so too, because Aaron, he loves the story of a country song because it's real and honest.
Mm-hmm.
And this sounds real and honest. Not that the other wines aren't.
Yeah.
But this is because when you're describing this married couple and That is a romantic story to me.
And I think
I love that.
Perfectly portrays that song too that
it
you
does.
Played. It was very family and
yeah. mm-hmm.
and meeting somebody and like building a life.
Yeah,
and,
yeah, yeah. yeah. yeah.
I think excellent. Right. We have our wine.
We did it.
Okay,
cool.
So this Thank is you, called Nickel Vineyard Naramata Syrah. So this is what we picked for you, Aaron. And I know it's an excellent choice.
I think we made a good choice.
I think so too. Mm-hmm. I'm excited. Thank you very, very much for coming.
You're welcome. Thanks for having me.
It's been a while, hey?
Yeah, it's been quite a while.
I mean, we did some work together in, dare I say, 2008.
Yeah, with Sarajevo and then flying in and out of Frankfurt, I think it was, or Munich,
yeah,
something like
fun.
That. Yeah, it was crazy.
For the military, Canadian
yep.
military. That was one of my proudest moments, I think.
Really?
Doing that, yeah.
There was just so many stories about all those places we went to mm-hmm. that was just mind-boggling, mm-hmm. really. And Sarajevo was one of the craziest places I think yeah. I've ever been. And knowing the history of the war in the 90s, early 90s, mm-hmm. and then talking to a lot of the military guys who were there at the time and went yeah. through a lot of stuff they went
Incredible.
Through. It was pretty crazy. But it was great to be hanging out with you then.
Yeah, it was lots of fun.
A couple of weeks, 3 weeks, I guess, something
yeah.
like that.
So. Yeah, it was good.
It was awesome. So
this show is mm-hmm. something that I've been wanting to do for many, many years. So thrilled that you're here for one of our first episodes.
Cool.
I'm very passionate about music, as you are,
yep.
and very passionate about wine.
Yes.
And I had this great idea to pair wine with musicians and their personalities. So we decided to choose Everything Wine to pair you with. And this beautiful girl, Lisa, who was the buyer for the store, knows a lot about wine. Jeff and her went through the store, and they ended up picking out three bottles. Okay. And then once we got down to the wire, we decided to go with this. And because you're a BC boy, and this is a BC wine.
Nice.
So it's a Syrah, Nicole Vineyard. And what I liked about this, too, we feel you're a hometown boy.
I am.
Yeah. And it felt like you would want to represent a wine that you have a husband and wife who are in the field.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay, well, let's see what this wine tastes like. I know it's going to be fantastic. I'm so excited.
It looks fantastic. It's wine. Oops. It's red wine.
It's red wine.
Who doesn't like red wine?
Well, it's funny. We weren't sure, but we thought if you didn't drink red wine, we knew your girlfriend would certainly like it.
Oh, yeah. We both love red wine a lot.
Who doesn't? Yeah, we'll see how it goes. Well, wasn't that nice? The BC wines have that quality, I find.
It is. Yeah. This is very great smelling.
Oh, my goodness.
That tastes like more.
Okay. Well, you feel free to sip along.
Yeah.
Let's do some talking.
Sure.
My goal is to get behind Aaron Pritchett, the famous Aaron Pritchett, and talk about little boy Aaron before all that stuff happened.
Sure.
But just to bring all of our viewers to date, you had an extensive career. I think in 1996 you started?
Yeah, around there. My musical history actually goes back further. I was never a musician, I have to admit. I was never a singer, you know, and I still don't consider myself a singer, musician, great songwriter, any of those. I just consider myself an entertainer. Mm-hmm. I try and just go out there and entertain people and make them feel better. And that's really what my goal is. My music through radio, but also live shows. How it all happened was in 1991, I was 20 years old, not quite 21 yet, and just had a baby and was married. And at 19, I got married.
Wow.
We went to this karaoke of all things. And my mom dragged me out to it, of course. Thanks, Mom. Because it really actually did start everything. And this she begged me to go up and sing a song for her. So I did. And it was probably the hardest song anybody could ever sing for their very first song, especially. But most people can't sing that song anyway. And I don't think I really did a good job.
What was the same song?
Waiting for a Girl Like You from Foreigner.
Oh,
I've been waiting for a girl like you. My very first song I ever sang.
That's high.
So the guy that was running the karaoke actually said, do you want to work for me? And I thought, well, okay, I guess he just wants me to help him with his equipment because he's lazy or I don't know. And next thing I know, I'm running the karaoke and, you know, long story short, it started me on doing that for a few years and just singing and getting my chops, you know. And singing every song under the sun that I knew that the list had, because most nights I was just doing the singing myself because nobody else wanted to sing.
Because nobody showed up? Oh, I see.
People were there, but they didn't want to sing.
Yeah, people are nervous.
So then I eventually got into a band and started a jam at Gabby's Country Cabaret in Langley. And my buddy at the time, who was the manager, Mike Pemberton, was the one who dragged me into that and said, I got a band for you. You just need to come and sing some songs for us on a Sunday and run a jam. So I did. And I was still doing karaoke at the time, as well as DJing a little bit here and there. So I had my hands in a bunch of different things and the pulse on what was happening in country music at the time, and especially what was coming through the States and the Canadian artists as well. And really started thinking, this is pretty cool. And I went into a talent search in 93. That was the first time I ever sang with a band, was in this
talent search
before I was running the jam. And I went to the Canadian finals, and I was the BC rep, and went there, and I blew it big time. But Paul Brandt was there. He was the Alberta representative. He's a 19-year-old kid.
Oh, my.
So we met and became friends and still remain friends to this day. And this talent search came along as well. Again, Project Discovery.
That's the one. You won $10,000, didn't you?
Yeah, 10 grand. Mm-hmm. And I think the big thing was we didn't split it as a band. Everybody just said, let's put it into the recording.
Very
so we
smart.
Recorded, did a few songs. And my first single came out of that. So I got to record the single as well as shoot a video.
Tom McKillop did the single,
mm-hmm. recorded the single, and it was at my request that he did it because I didn't believe in anybody else at that point. And we did the first single, Consider This, and it did really, really well. It wasn't my first single at radio. My very first single at radio was Heart Like a Hurricane, April 14th, 2000. It was the first time I ever heard that song on radio. I heard my voice on radio. Mm. But then, 2001 was a big, big year and a jump ahead and turned into what I've got now. And all I really wanted, like I said, I want to entertain people.
And you do that. You do that so well, Aaron.
So I was on a radio tour going across Canada promoting Dirt Road In 'Em, the new single that I just had. The album wasn't done. It wasn't going to be out till June 16th, of 2016. So I was doing this radio tour, and I went from Vancouver, actually Gabriola, where I live, went from Gabriola all the way to St. John's, Newfoundland, basically driving pretty much the whole way. And on this tour, I was stopping in Medicine Hat, and I got a phone call from Mike McGuire, who was working at Big Dog Radio in Regina, and he said, "Hey, I know you're here in 2 days, but I've got to give you the heads up on something. We're doing a few interviews that day while you're coming in to co-host the show for 2 hours." So I said, "Oh, okay, who?" And he said, "Well, the first one is Father Seamus O'Flanagan, and he's getting a head start on his bake sale for Christmas," and it's April. So I'm like, "What?" And he said, "The other one's Garth Brooks. So you can choose whichever one you want to interview." And so he knew he was joking.
Yeah,
and
that's awesome.
He said, I had each of us could ask one question because we only had 8 minutes or something with Garth. So I thought, okay, great. Well, this is cool. I've never met Garth. I was a Garth Brooks fan before I was a singer. You know, and it's all legitimate. Yeah. And so I was really excited to talk to him. And then I thought, well, I'm going to ask him two questions. One's just going to be a joke, and then I'll ask him the serious question. And it was, "Can I give you my agent's contact information? I'll give you $50. And I did it live, talking to Garth on the air. And he said, "Well, how about if you open the shows for me in June?"
Oh, my God. Can you imagine?
That's what they were calling. He was calling for was to promote the shows coming up in June. Yeah. So there's a video that's on YouTube that went viral at the time. People in Australia were calling me, England, going, "You were just on the news. I can't believe this."
That's
Garth
so powerful.
Brooks news. And then, I was just blown away. You could see my face go completely white, completely red, and just my heartbeat. It felt like motor was running. But yeah, it was pretty crazy, and he couldn't have been a nicer guy.
Well, I feel that. You feel that when you see his shows, and I'm not surprised that he did that. And isn't it wonderful to have that kind of power and to help somebody like you, give you that opportunity?
It's pretty cool.
And, you know, let's face it, you could deliver, right?
Well,
I mean, that's your crowd, too.
Yeah.
His crowd is your crowd.
And they said
it's a perfect marriage.
Originally, they just said, "It's just you by yourself playing acoustic." Mm-hmm. And I said, "Well, I'm comfortable playing acoustic live, but I'm not that great. Mm-hmm. So can I have two guys with me?" Okay. So I brought my son, Jordan, oldest son.
Wow.
He's turning 28 this year, and he's a huge Garth Brooks fan.
Oh, what a moment.
So he's also a metalhead, which is really weird. But yeah, he's a big Garth Brooks fan, so he got to have that moment as well, playing guitar with me and my other guitar player. So it was fantastic.
What's your day look like at home? Like, you're not on the road, you've done your tours, you're not making any more phone calls, you're on Gabriola, you got some time to yourself. What does that look like?
There's a lot of different things. Gabriola is not it's a little limited with what you can do on the island. There's a golf course, so I can go golfing if I'm feeling inclined. But for the most part, we just hang out outside because it's so beautiful there. The weather's better there than it is in Nanaimo or Vancouver. It's got this thing called the rain shadow, so the weather will split over some of the Gulf Islands, and Gabriel is one of the most impacted island of that rain shadow. So there's a lot more things you can do outside.
It's beautiful there. I was there when I visited Gary Philgard many years ago, but I fell in love with it.
It's incredible.
Yeah. So how do you feel, Aaron, about aging in the music business?
Don't we all hate
Dare
it?
I ask?
Well, you know what? The thing is that I got lucky. I have to admit, I did get lucky because I wrote a really stupid song that I thought nobody would ever like. And what happened was, I call it the Hold My Beer effect. So this song that I wrote
Huge
that
song
I thought
for
was
you.
Just going to be just a joke ended up being my biggest song
yeah.
so far. You know, it's that song that it shows people are going, oh, my bear. Oh,
I was there when yeah. we played on in our tours.
Exactly.
You know, I read that you said you love country music because it's about real people, mm-hmm. like real stories and real people, and you can.
Yep.
It's an outlet to say what you really want to say. You don't have to hide behind any
Absolutely.
Clever lyrics, and I think probably why I Hold My Beer resonated with people because you know the hard working class people yep. who. We need a release from that song. I can't think of a better song
yeah.
to just let it go and, you know, hold my beer. That's
yeah.
that's the charm in that. But that's a lot of your songs are like that. Very lighthearted and fun. You can't help but tap your toe and you want to be there. I want to be on the beach with you. You
well,
know?
That's, like, that's the whole point.
Yeah, and there's that mother and mm-hmm. daughter. What's that name of that song? I love that song.
Mama's Boy Meets
yeah,
Daddy's
yeah,
Girl.
Yeah, beautiful song. Yeah. So you had off that album, you did really well. You had three yeah. Songs that charted on Billboard in the top 10.
Top 10.
Yeah, that's excellent. Canada. Excellent. Yeah. Well, you've had, 25 years, would you say?
25 years in the industry for yeah. sure. Actually, I guess pushing 30. Now that I think about it, crazy.
Isn't it amazing that you can still
yeah.
be doing this?
And like I said, I only wanted one single and one yeah. video, and now I'm on my 30th video.
Well,
we're
very proud of you. I mean, you've had so many awards. I was blown away. Like Entertainer of the Year, Male Vocalist of the Year, Album of the Year, Songwriter of the Year, and not just once, numerous times. Video, Fan Choice, and these are the ones that you won. I didn't even go into the ones that you were nominated for. So that is cheers to that.
Thanks. And you know what? Getting older in the industry really isn't that bad. It's just
yeah,
you know.
Yeah, excellent. We're gonna sing a song. I can't
yeah,
wait.
Let's do it.
Thank you.
To let the good times roll, girl. If you're down, I'm down. Let's down a round or two. Shake the work week loose, me and you. I ain't a player, a hustler, but I'm going all in. You're a heartbreaker, baby, but tonight I don't care. I'm putting all my chips on that little red dress on you. Win or lose, it's worth a shot or two, yeah, maybe one more, just to talk to you and get you out on the floor. Girl, I know I don't usually dance, but tonight all bets are off. Oh, baby, it's off. You got me swinging for the fences, shooting for the moon. You're way out of my league, but I got nothing to lose. And by the end of the night, the only thing I got on my lips is Tennessee fire. Hey, why the hell not? A drink and we can see where it goes. While it a perfectly good Friday go to waste. So what do you say? It's worth a shot or two, yeah, maybe one more, just to talk to you and get you out on the floor. Girl, I know I don't usually dance, but tonight all bets are off. All baby, it's off. It's worth a shot or two.